Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fantasy Football for Dummies, Second Edition, by Martin A. Schulman, narrated by Barry Abrams. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to tables and figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability / disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. In 1999, I was exactly where you may be right now. I decided to give the whole fantasy football thing a try, even though I had no idea how to play. Back then, the online version of the game was just starting to take off, and Yahoo had just begun offering its free league services. I did a bit of research and talked to a few buddies about strategy, but I mainly learned the game through trial and errors. I had no definitive resource guide to help me get off to a good start in my fantasy football career. Things have changed today. Since 2007, Fantasy Football for Dummies has put helpful guidance and friendly advice right at your fingertips. The keys to a successful fantasy season, which I didn't have when I began to play the game. This resource can make your fantasy football season less frustrating. You can avoid many mistakes and start racking up victories by knowing the basics of the game, the popular strategies for winning, and the etiquette of league play. Also, when I began playing, I knew very little about the available online resources. I just bought the first fantasy magazine I saw and went from there. And yes, printed magazines still exist. This book also includes an overview of major fantasy football providers and expert websites that offer tools and advice you can turn to when looking to improve your team. Now, with this second edition, I've refined strategies and updated the facts to match today's NFL and fantasy rule sets, including flex and PPR. I also cover the biggest boom in fantasy football since the internet, daily fantasy football. In an all-new part 4 of this book, I deep dive into DraftKings, FanDuel, and all things DFS involving online prize money. It's fast-paced, exciting, and you can bet big to win big, but play at your own risk. Fantasy football was built to mirror the best parts of pro football, and it does just that. Fantasy football is as exciting and fun as it is frustrating and unpredictable. Hope for the best and expect the worst. About this book. Fantasy Football for Dummies gives you the foundational information you need to play fantasy football. This book is a unique guide because it offers in-depth lessons on how to play the game and serves as a reference for where to play and where to get great expert advice. Unlike most fantasy websites and magazines, which offer advice with the assumption that you're already a fantasy addict, this book serves the beginning fantasy player along with plenty of advice sprinkled throughout for more advanced players. although you can choose to play fantasy football on a wide array of web providers. To simplify matters throughout this book, I use the default settings for Yahoo. No matter what provider you choose, make sure you double-check the league settings before you start to play. Furthermore, because fantasy football is a game based on the National Football League, it can feature some confusing terminology. For example, each person who plays fantasy football is a player in the fantasy game, and they depend on the players in the NFL game. See what I mean? Therefore, when I refer to coaches, I mean you, the fantasy participant, unless I specifically say NFL coach. Whenever I say player, I'm referring to the NFL players who make up your fantasy league. Finally, fantasy sites and experts use a lot of positional shorthand based on NFL depth charts, and this book is no different. I call the starting running back the RB1, and his backups are called RB2 and RB3. You can apply the same shorthand when you're the king of your own team's depth chart. Here are the positional abbreviations to look for. QB equals quarterback. RB equals running back. WR equals wide receiver. TE equals tight end. K equals kicker. DEF equals team defense. D/ST equals defense/special teams. What you're not to read. Throughout the book, there might be personal asides or historical references to the crazy game we call fantasy football. These anecdotes, which I often place in sidebars, are not essential reading in order to grasp fantasy football. Foolish assumptions. When writing this book, I made a couple of assumptions about you, my dear reader. Here are my two main assumptions. 1. You're a football fan. I don't explain how offenses can get a first down or when the forward pass was invented. You know the pro league, and you know many of the NFL stars by name. Understanding the game helps you evaluate talent and choose quality players during the fantasy draft process and during the season. It's possible to stick only to expert advice and cheat sheets to play fantasy football, but I don't advise it. For a more in-depth look at the game and rules of football, check out Football for Dummies 6th Edition by Howie Long and John Zarnecki, Wiley. You own or have regular access to a computer or a smartphone, and you're not afraid to use it. Almost all fantasy leagues are run exclusively online, from the drafting process to weekly team management. I assume that you can surf the web, download an app, and click on links. Being able to navigate the internet quickly and effectively is part of the game. How this book is organized. Fantasy Football for Dummies explains the game to you from start, the draft, to finish, the championship. However, like the NFL, the fantasy season is never truly over. You can use the research information to scout players and potential sleepers year-round. This book is organized so that you can jump in anywhere, depending on your experience level and the status of your season and league. Part 1. The X's and O's of Fantasy Football. Just the basics, please. Part 1 provides readers with an overview of the game. You find out how it works, how different fantasy leagues are set up and run, why scoring is so important in fantasy football, and how you can join or create a league that's right for you. I also explain how you can prepare for the most fun day on the fantasy calendar, the all-important fantasy league draft. Part 2. Advanced Scouting and Drafting Secrets. Researching the NFL players and picking the best possible talent for your fantasy team is a very important aspect of fantasy football. This part provides guidelines for you to use when you try to separate the wheat from the chaff at the different roster positions. Then, when you're ready for draft day, this part explains important draft strategies to help you assemble your team. Part 3. Let the games begin. In-season strategy guide. After you assemble your dream team in the draft, or endure a nightmare brought on by another coach always selecting your coveted players, you need to know how to guide your team to glory during the fantasy season. This part walks you through your many in-season management duties and breaks down the most common issues you'll face and decisions you'll have to make. If you draft well and you make some shrewd moves during the season, your team may qualify for your league's playoffs, and you may even win your league championship. The fantasy postseason is its own beast, so I end this part by explaining the rules and strategies for enjoying postseason success. Part 4. Daily Fantasy Football. A new draft every week. Fantasy football can be fun, but what happens when you aren't interested in playing through a whole season? Is there a way to apply your fantasy football drafting skills for 1 week, or even just one game? Yes. It's called Daily Fantasy Football, and it's taking the NFL and fantasy sports by storm. Part 4 focuses on introducing you to this exciting recent development in fantasy sports by exploring the basics of finding a DFS provider, setting up an account, and then getting started entering tournaments and competitions. Learn the difference between popular contest types, from 50-50s to H2Hs to larger guaranteed prize pool tournaments worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. Part 5. The Part of Tens. Part 5 is the classic For Dummies feature, the Part of Tens. The chapters here are filled with quick reminders that you can refer to before your draft and well into the fantasy season. Specifically, I present 10 quick fixes you can make after your draft concludes and you determine that your team is less than perfect. I also cover 10 common rookie mistakes you should avoid at any time during your fantasy season. Finally, I offer 10 tricks and tips to get winning in daily fantasy contests and tournaments. Icons used in this book. To help you navigate your way through this book, I provide the following friendly and useful icons. These icons will be verbalized in this audiobook to enhance your reading pleasure and point out specific types of information. Tip. This icon provides some fantasy football advice in a nutshell. I give you specific actions or strategies you can implement to improve your team or your fantasy football gaming experience. Remember. Here you find important advice worth repeating and remembering. If you have time to only skim the chapters I provide here, these are the bits of information you should keep with you. Warning. Most fantasy advice follows the rule, but there are always exceptions, right? When I see a possible contradiction or a path that could lead you to fantasy failure or exile from the rest of your league mates, I warn you about it. Consider this icon a yellow flag. Where to go from here? Like all Four Dummies titles, this is a reference book, and each chapter is a modular piece about a specific area of fantasy football. You can skip around and not get lost. If you're totally new to the game, you can start your reading with Part 1. If you know the game but want to improve your skills as a fantasy coach, you may want to focus on Parts 2 and 3. If you already had your league's draft, you may want to skip to Part 3, which discusses in-season game management. If you are here to learn how to master daily fantasy sports play, then skip to Part 4. From the day you first sign up for a fantasy league to the day you hoist your league's championship trophy over your head to the day you sign up for another season, this book will be your guide through the world of fantasy football. No matter what you read, I wish you luck in your future fantasy adventures. 1. The X's and O's of fantasy football. Just the basics, please. In this part, if you're new to the game of fantasy football, Part 1 has you covered. Chapter 1 gives you the quick lowdown on fantasy football. In Chapter 2, I explain how fantasy points are scored and why scoring is so important to the game. Chapter 3 covers the types of leagues available to fantasy players and helps you determine which one to join if you aren't already in one. Finally, Chapter 4 helps prepare you for your fantasy draft so you can create a fantasy team that would make NFL general managers green with envy. Chapter 1. The Reality of Fantasy Football. What's it all about? In this chapter, focusing on fantasy football's big picture, getting up to speed on the draft process, filling your roster with the right players, reviewing the responsibilities of team management, starting your fantasy journey. Sports fans usually root only for their favorite local teams, but fantasy sports allow the die-hard sports fan to root for every team. In fact, playing fantasy makes watching every real game more fun and exciting. Millions of online fantasy sports enthusiasts can't be wrong. The biggest of all the fantasy sports is fantasy football, and after you start playing, you'll quickly know why. But before you start playing fantasy football, you need to know the basics. This chapter gives you a quick overview of fantasy football. Consider this chapter your jumping-off point into fantasy football. If you already know how to play but want to improve your game, feel free to skip to Chapter 4. However, if you keep reading, you may discover something about fantasy football that you didn't know. This chapter focuses on season-long fantasy football leagues, also known as standard leagues. If you're looking to play daily fantasy football, or DFS, these basics still apply, and the differences between the two is explained in more detail in Part 4. Understanding Fantasy Football: A Quick Overview. What is fantasy football all about? Instead of just watching the NFL game, fantasy football allows you to feel like you're part of the action by assembling an all-star lineup of the best players in the league. Fantasy allows you to imagine the fireworks of all those football stars playing as one unit. In this section, I give you a quick walkthrough of the basics of fantasy football so you can get a better grasp of this popular activity you're considering playing. How fantasy and the NFL differ. When comparing fantasy and the NFL, two significant differences stick out. In the NFL, all that matters is which team wins or loses. In fantasy, however, NFL wins and losses don't count. Instead of team stats, fantasy relies not only on scored touchdowns, but also on individual stats, such as yards gained, to calculate each fantasy player's performance based on a determined league scoring system. See Chapter 2 for more on scoring. The results are called fantasy points, and your team's fantasy point total is the sum of your starting players' efforts. Your fantasy team will win or lose based on those results. So, in a way, fantasy football and the NFL both are about wins and losses that lead up to the best teams battling in a playoff format to decide a champion. See Chapter 12. The other major difference is that fantasy teams consist of players from every team in the league, not just one NFL team. See the Drafting the Right Players for Your Roster section later in this chapter for a breakdown of a fantasy team roster. Only the best players are drafted. Thus, each team is a sports fan's fantasy. Everything else in the game tries to reflect and simulate real football. How to play fantasy football. So, you've decided that you want to play fantasy football. Perhaps a buddy asked you to join a league, or maybe a coworker started talking trash and bet that he could easily beat you in a new league that he's forming. Perhaps you don't know anyone who plays, but you're always hearing about fantasy football and you want to join a public league to find out what the fuss is all about. Remember, no matter your reasons for playing fantasy football, you're in for a fun-filled experience that's sure to get you hooked. I can guarantee that at different times, this game can make you cheer, drive you nuts, and break your heart. The following list gives you a snapshot of what happens in a fantasy season. 1. You join a league. You can join a public league, where anyone can sign up for a spot, or a private league, where you need an invitation to play. Some people play just for fun, and some play for serious coin. League selection is an important factor, so don't take it lightly. Chapter 3 discusses the different kinds of leagues and what to look for when signing up for one. 2. You prepare for your league draft by scouting players. Before choosing your fantasy team, you need to research all the available players so you can pre-rank them according to your personal preference. In chapters 5, 6, and 7, I tell you what I look for when scouting the NFL so you can become your own expert. 3. You build your fantasy team via the draft. The draft is the most fun and exciting day of the fantasy season. During the draft, each fantasy coach selects one NFL player at a time until the rosters are complete. Chapter 4 explains how to prepare for every type of draft and how the draft works. Chapters 8 and 9 offer in-depth draft strategies to help you outsmart your opponents and create a fantasy force. 4. Your team competes against another team every week. During the NFL season, the real teams face each other, and so do the fantasy teams in your league. The players' real-time stats are converted into fantasy points by your league provider, and in the most common head-to-head leagues, the fantasy team that scores the most points wins the game for the week. Points-based leagues work a little differently. Check out Chapter 2 for a breakdown of how fantasy scoring works. 5. You make moves to improve your team. As a fantasy coach, you're in total control. You can drop players you think aren't good enough and replace them with free agents. If one of your starters gets hurt, you can bench him and start a healthy player instead. You may even make a trade offer to another coach. Chapters 10 and 11 explain how to manage your team each week and how to adjust your roster via player movement. 6. Your team hopefully makes the playoffs and wins your league. Only the strong survive, and at the end of the fantasy season, the top teams square off in a tournament to decide the league champion. Chapter 12 offers some strategic advice for managing your playoff team and presents a breakdown of the various playoff formats. The last team standing may win a trophy, a cash prize, or just honor. But make no mistake, there will be only one winner. How scoring makes you a winner. Fantasy football simulates the real deal by using a performance-based scoring system. A touchdown, TD, is worth 6 points for an NFL team and 6 fantasy points for a player on a fantasy team. For rushing or receiving touchdowns, many leagues count passing TDs for 4 points. Fantasy players are also awarded 0.5 or 1 point per catch, points for yardage gained, such as 1 point for every 10 yards gained rushing or receiving. Bad NFL plays often count as negative fantasy points. Interceptions and fumbles lost can be worth -1 to -2 points, respectively. In general, every statistic can be used to rate a player's achievements, good and bad, depending on your fantasy league. Remember, your fantasy team's final score each week is the sum of all your starting players' fantasy points. Table 1-1, which can be found in the print version of the book, shows an example of fantasy scoring for 1 week in a league with fractional and negative points. Don't worry about having to calculate all this each week. Your league provider does the math for you. For more specifics about scoring, check out Chapter 2. How important fantasy terms keep you in the loop. Like the rest of the sports world, fantasy sports has a lingo all its own. The slang terms are all fairly easy to grasp and fun to use, so don't be scared off. I include the following list so you can get a good feel for these fantasy football terms before you start playing, and I use them repeatedly throughout the book. Breakout. When a player goes from average to great. Bye week. Every NFL team is inactive once during the regular season. An NFL team's off week is its bye week. Cheat sheets. The list of pre-ranked players, overall and by position. See Chapter 4. Collusion. Two coaches working together to win a league. See Chapter 11. Daily Fantasy, an alternative to standard fantasy football where you bet money on individual weeks or games. See Part 4. Damaged Goods, when a player involved in a trade is hurt. See Chapter 11. Elite, the highest-ranked players at their positions. Fantasy Formula, a simple way to evaluate a player's potential. Skill plus opportunity equals success. Fantasy Worthy, a player who plays enough to make a fantasy impact. Fleecing, taking advantage of a bad coach in a lopsided trade. See Chapter 11. Flex, a flexible slot on your roster where you can select from multiple positions. See Chapter 6. Game time decision, waiting to see if a hurt player will start. Status won't be revealed until inactive lists are posted 90 minutes before kickoff. See Chapter 10. Insurance policy, formerly known as handcuffing, drafting a backup and a starter from the same NFL team. Head to Chapter 9. Keeper League, coaches retain a certain number of players from one season to the next. League settings, the league rules and stat modifiers that determine fantasy point values. Pre-rankings, how NFL players are rated for fantasy purposes before the season starts. Private League, a league you can join by invitation only and that's controlled by a commissioner. See Chapter 3. Public League, anyone can sign up and play. See Chapter 3. Sleeper, a little-known player who's ready to awaken and be great. Star, a top-rated fantasy starter. Trade bait, good players you can offer to other coaches. Check out Chapter 11. Trading deadline, last day of the season to make trades. See Chapter 11. Vulture back, a running back who steals goal line carries from the starter. Jump to Chapter 5. Waiver wire, dropped players are here before they become free agents. Check out Chapter 11. Recognizing that fantasy success starts with the draft. Before the NFL season begins, every fantasy league must conduct a draft to fill the team's rosters. Because there are 32 NFL teams and often only 8 to 14 fantasy teams in any given league, a fantasy team should have the cream of the NFL crop. I'm talking all pros, pro bowlers, and other valuable commodities. This section gives you the highlights of a draft. Chapter 4 gives you the complete lowdown on preparing for and understanding a fantasy draft. Part 4 covers constructing lineups for daily fantasy sports, which is slightly different. What draft? Am I joining the army? A fantasy draft is where you build your fantasy team in preparation for the season and its weekly management. In a public league, the draft occurs at a preset time determined by the league provider. In a private league, your league commissioner chooses a draft type and a draft date for your league and notifies the coaches, usually by email. Chapter 4 explains the different draft formats. Here are the three most common ways that a draft can be run. Live offline draft. In a live offline draft, all the coaches decide on a place and a time to meet and select their players. This old-fashioned way to start a season is the most fun, in my opinion, even though it isn't always practical if your league members are spread across the country. Even so, many coaches plan an annual road trip to be at the draft in person, no matter where it's being held. Live online draft. A live online draft is the most popular and the easiest way to gather your league to draft players. Your fantasy league website provider uses real-time technology to run the draft online. Each coach logs into the site at the specified draft time and uses the draft interface to select the available players they want to draft. auto-pick draft. An auto-pick draft occurs online, but your league provider drafts each team for the league. Coaches don't have to log in at a specific time or place, but no one has control over the actual draft. Public leagues often use this format because it's hard to get 12 coaches to agree on a draft time when they don't know each other. Identifying the two types of drafts. Most fantasy football leagues have drafts that use one of the following formats: the snake draft or the salary cap draft, a format previously known as auction style. The following sections cover these drafts and briefly explain how they work. Chapter 4 dives deep into the differences between these two draft types and what you need to do to prepare for each one. Tip: if you're new to fantasy football or don't want to make a huge time commitment, I recommend playing in a snake draft league. If you're an experienced player or just a rabid football fan, read up on the salary cap draft. You may welcome the challenge. Snaking through standard draft rules. The standard draft is in a snake draft format. The snake draft is divided into rounds, one round for every available roster spot on each team. For example, if your league has 15-man rosters, your draft will have 15 rounds. In a snake draft, each fantasy coach has one pick in each round. Each team makes its first round pick based on a predetermined order. See Chapter 4 for deciding draft order. When the first round is over, the team that picked last in the first round picks first in the second round. In other words, the draft snakes back on itself. The team that had the first pick in the first round now has the last pick in the second round and the first pick in the third round. The process continues through all of the rounds of the draft. If you can picture a snake moving back and forth in an S pattern, you'll get the idea. Remember, the key to building a good team in a snake draft is preparing based on your draft position. If you get an earlier pick, you'll get the chance to draft one of the biggest stars in the NFL. If you have a later pick, you'll land two top 15 overall players rather than just the one elite player. Either way, you can win a fantasy league by drafting well, regardless of your draft position. For more on draft prep and strategy, see Chapters 4, 8, and 9. Grasping salary cap draft rules. A fantasy salary cap draft works much like eBay, except that you offer on NFL players rather than antiques or gadgets. In a salary cap draft, each NFL player is assigned a unit value, normally in dollars, and every fantasy team has a unit budget. Each team must fill its roster requirements without going over budget. You can offer as much as you want for a player, as long as you still have enough units left to complete the rest of your roster. Often, but not always, these units are described as dollars. For example, if you have a 20-player roster to fill and a budget of $200, the maximum you could offer for your first player would be $181, which would leave you with $1 per player for the remaining 19 slots. However, this would be absurd, and doing so would leave your fantasy team in lots of trouble. A salary cap draft still has rounds. The number of rounds mirrors the number of roster spots, but instead of drafting a player when it's your turn in a round, you nominate a player and start the offering at an amount of your choice. If no other team out-offers you, the player is yours. If another team makes an offer, the offering continues until no team surpasses the highest current offer. The player is awarded to the highest offerer. Each coach can nominate one player per round. This process continues until all the rosters are filled. Chapter 4 has more info on preparing for a salary cap draft, and Chapter 8 gives you some strategies. Daily fantasy football almost exclusively uses a salary cap-based format, which isn't the same as salary cap drafts. DFS usually have a salary cap of $50,000 to $60,000 per contest, rather than the $200 commonly used in traditional fantasy leagues that use salary cap drafts to put together their rosters prior to the season. For more on daily fantasy, see Part 4. drafting the right players for your roster. An NFL team has 53 players total, with 11 starters on offense and 11 starters on defense. Luckily, your fantasy roster won't be as extensive or complex, unless you play in an extreme league, which is beyond this book's scope. When you research your league and find out how many roster spots you have, you can turn your attention to preparing for your draft based on those requirements. Remember, the roster for your fantasy football team will be quite specific, depending on your league. The following list presents the default roster for a Yahoo Public League. This team has 9 starting slots and 6 bench slots, 6 players, any position, and 2 IR slots, for a total of 15 fantasy players. In this league, the draft would last for 15 rounds. Quarterback, wide receiver 1, WR1, wide receiver 2, WR2, running back 1, RB1, running back 2, RB2, tight end, TE, flex, WR, RB, or TE, kicker, K, team defense / special teams, team DEF / ST, 6 bench players. Breaking down positions. The major positions on your fantasy roster are the same as the major positions on offense in football. Running backs take center stage in fantasy football, not quarterbacks, and in Chapter 5 I explain why. Wide receivers are the unsung heroes of fantasy football because they can score plenty of fantasy points, but they're often overshadowed by running backs and quarterbacks. However, with the introduction of points per reception or PPR leagues, the wide receiver has regained its preeminent position as a fantasy points machine. Only a few tight ends are major parts of their team's offensive game plans. Thus, a tight end's impact on your fantasy team is often limited. As for the kickers, most of them get the job done, so you only need to draft 1. The last position in your starting lineup isn't usually based on individual stats, but on the stats of everyone on an NFL team's defense as a whole, focusing on turnovers, points allowed, as well as defense / special teams touchdowns. You select an NFL's defense to start each week, and you score fantasy points based on everything from TDs to sacks. See Chapter 2. In almost all formats, special teams touchdowns are counted, but it's very rare for return yardage to be counted as well. In these types of leagues, the defense will be called D/ST, defense/special teams. More advanced leagues use individual defensive player, IDP, positions. In these types of leagues, you draft individual defensive players rather than the team defense. Tip: if you're a fantasy football novice, focus on the offensive players and a team defense for now, and consider joining an IDP league in the future. For more on scouting defenses, see Chapter 7. In addition to the starting lineup, each team also has backup players sitting on the bench. The size of your bench depends on the type of league you're in and on how many starters you have. Most benches range from 5 to 10 players. Every NFL team has 1 week of the season off, the bye week. All players face some tough matchups, and injuries are sure to rear their ugly head, so your bench will play a huge role in deciding your fantasy fate. Warning: most leagues have roster rules that teams must follow during the draft. For example, you can't draft only running backs and leave your roster without a tight end. The common requirements state that each team must have a complete starting lineup based on league settings, but your bench players can play any position. Some leagues also set bench requirements. Usually, you can carry as many position players as you choose, but some leagues have restrictions to prevent collusion and unfair play. For example, some leagues may limit you to 2 quarterbacks, 2 tight ends, and 2 defenses, with no limit on wide receivers and running backs. Rating players with the fantasy formula. How do you know whom to draft and which players at each position are right for your team? Every league provider and fantasy expert site pre-ranks the players for you from top to bottom. These lists of players are also referred to as pre-rankings or cheat sheets. They're quick reference tools you can use when deciding which player to draft next. Check out Chapter 4 for more on cheat sheets. Remember, in order to excel at fantasy football, you need to become your own expert, study the NFL, and trust your own instincts. How do the experts determine their rankings and predict which players will be fantasy stars? They use an equation that I call the fantasy formula. Skill plus opportunity equals success. When researching the NFL, you'll be looking for the players with the talents needed to excel and whose teams give them chances to use those skills. I emphasize the fantasy formula in chapters 5, 6, and 7, which explain how to scout the league and pre-rank all the best players by position. Chapters 8 and 9 discuss important strategies for you to undertake during the draft and help you pick the best available players for your roster. Your new day job. Managing your team week by week. After you draft your roster and talk trash about your league mates' picks while proclaiming your dominance, you can't just sit there and do nothing with your team. If you do, you'll be the one on the butt end of the jokes. If you want to win your league, you have to be proactive and manage your team each week. This section briefly covers the important pointers to remember when managing your team on a weekly basis. Chapters 10 and 11 give you a rundown. Setting your lineup. The most important responsibility a fantasy coach has is to field the best possible team every week. Even if the real world demands much of your time or your team has a losing record, your league's integrity depends on each coach playing to win for the entire season. Remember, the easiest way to stay in the game and in the championship picture is to make sure you have a complete and competitive lineup before the NFL games begin each week. Here are some of the common reasons why you need to change your starting lineup each week to stay competitive. Injuries. Injuries happen in the NFL each week, and they're part of what makes fantasy football challenging. If your best player gets knocked out for the season, you'll be hard-pressed to find a worthy replacement. However, with a little research and by counting on your draft depth, you can insert capable players into your lineup each week. Matchups. Each fantasy team has a core of star players that must start every week when healthy. But when making choices at your other lineup positions, you need to consider each NFL game and which of those matchups are more likely to give your fantasy players the best chance to produce. Researching matchups is the key to making the best possible lineup choices each week. For more on playing the matchups, see Chapter 10. Bye weeks. During the season, each NFL team has 1 week off. It's bye week. You need to bench a team's players during its bye week in favor of active players on your bench. If you prepare for your draft correctly, these open dates won't come as a surprise, and your bench players will be ready to contribute. Performance. Athletes tend to play in streaks, either hot or cold. When making the tougher lineup decisions, you can check the stats for the last few games and see who's playing well and who needs to take a seat on your bench. Making changes to your roster. The squad you draft won't be perfect. It may not be balanced, and your players won't stay healthy for the whole year. Therefore, you need to make roster changes during the season. As a fantasy coach, you're more like a virtual general manager in this way. Of course, the real question is when to change your roster in order to improve your team. The following sections let you know your basic options for changing your roster during the season. Remember, every league provider has different default rules governing player movement, but you can generally adjust your roster right up until game time. In addition, private league commissioners can add to or modify these rules as they see fit. For example, some leagues make all non-rostered players available only on waivers, and others stipulate that adds or drops must be done by using a blind offering system. See Chapter 11. More restrictive league rules make your job more difficult. Always know your league rules and settings before you draft your team and play the game. adding and dropping players. During the season, you can add or drop players to replace injured players or to upgrade at positions of need, where your draft left you thin or where players are underperforming. You can add or drop players in one of two ways. See Chapter 11 for more. The free agency pool. In Yahoo default leagues, all undrafted fantasy players begin the season as free agents, which means they're available to be added to your roster at any time. You can swap any player on your roster for any free agent player using your league's list of available players. Simply create an open roster slot by dropping one of your current players and then adding the new player. Many free agent pickups will surprise you and become staples in your lineup, so making good adds or drops is one of the keys to fantasy success. The waiver wire. If another team drops a player, the player goes on waivers for a limited time before becoming a free agent. This means all coaches have a set amount of time, usually 2 days, to decide if they want to add them to their teams. In order to add a player on waivers, you must make a waiver claim by selecting him and a player on your roster to be dropped, and wait until the waiver period has expired. If you have the highest waiver priority, set in reverse order of your draft at the start of the season, you're awarded that player. After a claim is awarded, your waiver priority drops to the lowest number. Trading with other coaches. If your team needs help and you can't fix it via free agency, it may be time to make a trade offer. Of course, making a good trade is easier said than done, because you have to give up someone good in order to get someone good, which is one of the reasons drafting for depth is so important. Closing a deal can be tough, but proposing a deal is a breeze. Thanks to online technology, you just select the players you want and the players you're willing to give up, and your site automatically submits the trade to the other coach. That coach then accepts or rejects your proposal or makes a counteroffer. Your opponents won't always agree with your assessments of the players involved, so always be diplomatic and listen to what they have to say. Trade negotiations that become ugly almost never end well. For more on trade scenarios and for trade advice, check out Chapter 11. Striving for the Fantasy Championship. As the professional football season marches on and fall becomes winter, the NFL separates its pretenders from the contenders. The same transformation occurs in fantasy football. When the NFL's best teams are fighting for playoff berths, most fantasy leagues begin their postseasons. The formats vary for deciding fantasy championships, but most leagues use a single elimination tournament among the best teams in the leagues. At the end of the standard fantasy postseason, two teams battle for the league's crown in the championship game. They battle for glory, for trophies, for cash, for bragging rights, or for the love of the game. May the best team win! Chapter 12 covers what you need to do to succeed in the fantasy playoffs. The following sections introduce the different facets of the fantasy postseason. Weeks 15 to 17, the fantasy postseason. The fantasy playoffs take place toward the end of the NFL regular season so that all 32 teams and their players are still playing. Depending on the size of your league and the playoff format, most fantasy postseasons begin somewhere between weeks 15 or 16 and conclude a week before the end of the NFL regular season in week 17. Smaller leagues may feature only two playoff teams and one playoff game. Larger leagues may have six or more playoff teams, which can mean playoff games that cover 3 weeks. Your league's championship. Getting to the finals and winning your fantasy league is what fantasy football is all about. After all, only first place gets the prize and the bragging rights. Watching your NFL players while tracking your fantasy football championship game online is an adrenaline rush you can't duplicate in other fantasy sports. You'll be cheering, screaming, and biting your nails. And if you win, don't gloat too much because your league will be gunning for you next season. Are you ready to play? Fantasy football can be a fun and rewarding venture. Are you interested in getting in touch with your fantasy persona? If so, jump on in. The water is amazing. Keep the following in mind based on your fantasy needs. If you're a beginner looking to join a league, start in Chapter 3 on league types. If you are looking for daily fantasy football leagues, check out Chapters 13 and 16. If you've been invited to play in a league for the first time, start in Part 1. Some of the lingo may be new to you, but knowing your league's setup will be useful when pre-ranking, drafting, and managing your team. Then read Chapters 2 and 4 before diving into Parts 2 and 3. If you've played fantasy football before, you may want to start with Part 2. Knowing what to look for when ranking players and not just following some expert cheat sheets blindly is what will take your game to the next level. Part 3 reviews some draft strategies that you may have heard of but haven't fully embraced. How fantasy football began. In 1962, Bill Wink Winkenbach, a limited partner in the Oakland Raiders, and a group of die-hard local football businessmen founded GOPPPL, the Greater Oakland Professional Pigskin Prognosticators League. Wink and his buddies hammered out the rules for drafting players from all the teams, and on draft day in 1963, fantasy football was born. For more info on the history of the game, check out fspnet.com/wink.pdf. Fantasy football has been going strong ever since, but it really took off with the growth of the internet in the mid-1990s. Online league providers make playing easy for beginners and experts alike by compiling all the scoring results each week during the football season. The web also offers tons of fantasy expert sites filled with handy advice and stats to help every coach research the players and make smart choices when drafting and managing teams. Chapter 2. Just Score, Baby! The Name of the Fantasy Game. In this chapter, realizing the impact of scoring in fantasy football. Getting offensive for the bulk of your scoring. Examining defense's role in the scoring picture. Picking a scoring format that suits your style. In real sports, the team that scores the most points wins. The same goes for fantasy football. There are baskets in basketball, runs in baseball, and goals in hockey, but scoring in fantasy football entails more than just getting the ball into the end zone and between the uprights. Many statistics show the value and ability of players beyond their actual points scored, and those stats translate into fantasy points for your team. This chapter explains how scoring works in fantasy football and how it differs from the NFL. Note, the default settings I refer to in this chapter and in this book are the default settings on Yahoo's fantasy football platform, but other leagues use different scoring modifiers that may even affect your draft strategy. Check with your league and acquaint yourself with its scoring default settings before you do anything. Scoring 101. Only the basics. Winning in traditional fantasy football, not daily fantasy, which will be covered in Part 4, leagues, is no different than winning in the NFL. Two teams play each other in season-long formats, and the team that scores the most points wins. However, the big difference is how points are scored. To give you a broad overview of scoring and to touch on something you probably already know if you're a football fan, in the NFL, scoring breaks down as follows. Touchdowns, 6 points. Field goals, 3 points. Safeties, 2 points. 2-point conversions, 2 points. Extra points, 1 point. Remember, in fantasy, however, a team scores points based on each player's performance and personal stats, in addition to the standard NFL point system, and not on the NFL team's win-loss records. The star offensive players who can run, catch, and pass for big yards, and not just score, are the elite players in the fantasy world. In essence, fantasy rewards a player for playing a good game even if he doesn't score lots of touchdowns. Scoring touchdowns isn't easy in the NFL, and just because an offensive player can't reach the end zone doesn't mean he's having a bad game. Fantasy football also awards points to kickers who kick field goals and extra points, and to team defenses that can score fantasy points by limiting points allowed and creating turnovers, in addition to scoring touchdowns and safeties. Check out the Shooting for Shutouts, Scoring with Defense section later in this chapter for more info. Basically, anything from fumble recoveries to receptions to field goal distance can add up for your fantasy team. Every league provider has a default setting for the stats that will convert to fantasy scoring, but any NFL stat can translate into fantasy points. Only your league commissioner can make the decision to change any defaults. Tip: to know your league's scoring default, make sure you check out your league's scoring system when preparing for your season. The scoring rules of your league may affect your draft strategy. See Chapter 4, and will affect the outcome of each game during the season. The proofs in the points. Offensive fantasy scoring. The old saying goes, defense wins championships, but football fans know that offense makes the highlights. Exciting players who move the chains and score the touchdowns have always been the game's superstars, so fantasy football was designed to focus on the offense. Big-time quarterbacks, running backs, and wide receivers are the heart of any good fantasy team, and their total fantasy points scored will make or break your season. This section gives you a basic breakdown of the default scoring values by position for the individual offensive positions, using Yahoo as a default setting. I also explain why each position is valuable to your fantasy team and how the players can help you rack up fantasy points on game day. For a more detailed analysis of each offensive position and how the scoring system will affect your fantasy draft, check out the chapters in Part 2. Running backs. In most league formats, running backs are the most valuable players in fantasy football because they have plenty of opportunities to score fantasy points, and the great ones are hard to come by. This is because of the relative scarcity of good running backs to fill all your roster spots. With 32 teams in the NFL, you have 32 choices for starting quarterbacks to slot into your single quarterback roster slot. And since each NFL team starts two wide receivers, this means you have 64 starters to choose from for the two or three wide receiver slots in your lineup. But since NFL teams only have one starting running back each, and you need to fill two running back slots and flex options in your lineup every week, good running backs can go very quickly in the draft. More carries and receptions equal more chances to rack up yards and to score in the red zone, the area inside the opponent's 20-yard line. The following list breaks down the default scoring for running backs on Yahoo. Rushing yards, 1 point per 10 yards. Rushing touchdowns, 6 points. Catches, 0.5 point per reception. Receiving yards, 1 point per 10 yards. Receiving touchdowns, 6 points. Kick or punt return touchdowns, 6 points. 2 point conversions, 2 points. Fumbles lost, -2 points. For every 10 rushing yards or receiving yards, your player and fantasy team get a point, compared to 25 passing yards to net the same amount. Check out the quarterbacks section to compare. Rushing yards are more difficult to get in the NFL, so most fantasy scoring systems make them more valuable. And receivers must rely on getting open and on their quarterbacks finding them. Plus, they have to catch the ball to get the points, which isn't as easy as it sounds. All the running back has to do is take the handoff from the quarterback and hit the hole. For these reasons, running backs are the most valuable players in fantasy football, especially in full-point PPR leagues. And not only do they run for touchdowns, they gain points for yardage gained via the pass. Not many quarterbacks and receivers can get valuable rushing yards. A running back who can run and receive is extremely valuable. Check out Chapter 5 for more on scouting running backs. Tip: many third-down-slash-change-of-pace backs, better at catching passes, and vulture running backs, a running back who steals goal-line carries from the starter, are still valuable on your fantasy roster. A 6-point touchdown is worth 60 rushing yards, and a reception is worth 5 rushing yards. These backup running backs might also become starters due to injury, so don't sleep on them when setting your lineups or drafting. Wide receivers. Again, depending on the scoring system of your league, wide receivers are the second most valuable players in fantasy football behind running backs, particularly because of the scarcity of truly elite running backs. The wide receiver position's value isn't because they score more points than quarterbacks, it's because there are fewer high-scoring wide receivers in the league, and you have to start two or three each week as opposed to one quarterback. In full-point PPR formats, which are becoming more common across the board, top wide receivers are gold. In addition, wide receivers get hit and tackled less than quarterbacks and running backs, so they make fewer mistakes, which means fewer negative points on average. They also take less pounding than running backs. With that in mind, NFL teams are turning to running back timeshares, whereas starting wide receivers tend to record higher snap count percentages. The following list breaks down the default scoring for wide receivers on Yahoo. Catches, 0.5 point per reception. Receiving yards, 1 point per 10 yards. Receiving touchdowns, 6 points. Rushing yards, 1 point per 10 yards. Rushing touchdowns, 6 points. Kick or punt return touchdowns, 6 points. 2-point conversions, 2 points. Fumbles lost, negative 2 points. Remember, the wide receiver position has more depth in the NFL than the running back position, which makes wide receivers less valuable during fantasy drafts. There are simply more wide receivers to choose from. However, their fantasy points are very similar, the only difference being that very few wide receivers gain rushing yards or score rushing touchdowns on a regular basis, so don't underestimate the need for having good wide receivers on your team. A great wide receiver can dominate a game and carry a fantasy team if he gets enough passes thrown his way from a good quarterback. Head to Chapter 6 for info on scouting and valuing wide receivers. Quarterbacks. Because the quarterback is the one player who touches the ball on nearly every down, it seems like he'd be the player who scores the most points, right? Good quarterbacks do score lots of points, but most quarterbacks are held back by the many opportunities for negative points based on mistakes and by the scoring systems from most league providers. What devalues the quarterback the most is that there's not much position scarcity, which means there are more viable options to draft than with other skill positions, and there tends to be less separation in terms of scoring, apart from the truly elite options. The following list breaks down the default scoring for quarterbacks on Yahoo. Passing yards, 1 point per 25 yards. Passing touchdowns, 4 points. Rushing yards, 1 point per 10 yards. Rushing touchdowns, 6 points. 2-point conversions, 2 points. Fumbles lost, negative 2 points. Interceptions, negative 1 point. Sacks, 0 points. If each turnover is worth negative 1 or negative 2 points, 3 turnovers in a game will negate 1 touchdown, which brings down the overall value of quarterbacks. Negative points make fantasy football a more realistic simulation of real football. If an NFL quarterback throws an interception, it hurts his team, so it should hurt your fantasy team too. Many leagues don't use negative points, which is a scoring loophole that can improve the draft value of mistake-prone quarterbacks who complete lots of passes on losing teams. And many leagues, including Yahoo Default, count passing touchdowns as only 4 points instead of 6, which lowers the draft value of all quarterbacks versus running backs and wide receivers. Tip: a quarterback who can run the ball effectively when necessary can score a ton of fantasy points and literally run away with your fantasy league. However, since quarterbacks tend to get hit the most on a weekly basis between poor blocking, poor pocket mobility, and reckless play, a running quarterback runs a greater risk of being injured. If you draft a running quarterback, be sure to draft a good fantasy backup just in case your starter gets hurt. Check out Chapter 5 for more on pre-ranking quarterbacks. Tight ends. Tight ends score fantasy teams' points by catching passes, so their scoring stats are the same as the wide receivers. Check out the wide receivers section earlier in this chapter for the breakdown. Non-elite tight ends get fewer looks than the top 20 wide receivers, and average tight ends don't have much value outside of matchup-based starts. But they often get short yardage touchdowns and two-point conversions in the red zone, which raises their value. A few truly elite, there's usually one or two tight ends per year that put up numbers that would equal top-level wide receivers, can become highly coveted options near the top of the draft. Head to Chapter 6 for info on scouting tight ends. Remember, as long as your league awards the full 6 points for a receiving touchdown, consider tight ends more valuable than all the kickers and most of the team defenses, but not as valuable as the big three offensive positions: quarterback, running back, and wide receiver. Kickers. Kickers just score points, which is nice. Having a good kicker is helpful and can be an edge, but note that the overall points they put up and the numerical difference between the top options and lesser ones isn't as stark as it is at other positions. For example, this year the raw point difference between the top kicker and the number 12 scorer was 20 points total. The gap between running back wide receiver tight end 1 and running back wide receiver tight end 2 was much more. Note, many fantasy league providers award bonus points for longer kicks and penalize kickers for missing short kicks and extra points. The following list breaks down the default scoring for kickers on Yahoo. Field goal 0 and 19 yards, 3 points. Field goal 20 and 29 yards, 3 points. Field goal 30 and 39 yards, 3 points. Field goal 40 and 49 yards, 4 points. Field goal 50 plus yards, 5 points. Field goal missed, 0 points. Extra point made, 1 point. Extra point missed, 0 points. Remember, because of many factors, predicting which kickers will produce can be tricky. Therefore, you should always draft kickers in the latter rounds, and don't be afraid to switch kickers frequently during the season, even on a weekly basis if need be. Changing a starter weekly is often called streaming, which can be an effective strategy for team defenses as well as kickers, based on matchup difficulty and weather. Shooting for shutouts, scoring with defense. Defense often gets lost in the shuffle in fantasy football. People want to watch offensive players dancing in the end zone, not tackles for no gain. But if you want to win your fantasy league, you need to go on the offensive to scout and draft a good defense. Defensive players can create turnovers, cause yardage losses for an offense, score touchdowns, and even make plays on special teams. In other words, they make plays that impact the game. The scoring system of most fantasy leagues tracks defensive performance. In terms of defense, most fantasy leagues break down defensive scoring in two ways: team defense / special teams. Standard fantasy leagues combine one defense's stats into one fantasy player called the team defense, DEF on Yahoo, and/or defense / special teams, D/ST, on other fantasy football sites. Individual players. In more advanced leagues, each fantasy coach drafts defensive position players and uses an individual scoring system, much like with the offensive players. This section looks at both options and how they affect scoring in fantasy football. Check out Chapter 7 for more info on scouting defenses. Dissecting team defense scoring. The team defense can be a major contributor to your fantasy team, depending on your league's scoring system. Sacks, interceptions, and fumble recoveries quickly add up and lead to a dominant defensive game. If your team defense crushes its opponent, it may even score the elusive shutout, worth 10 big fantasy points. If your defense gets lit up and gives up lots of points, many leagues penalize you for their performance. The special teams unit can also score you a quick 6 by returning a kick or a punt for a touchdown, but it's very rare. The following list breaks down the default scoring for team DSTs on Yahoo. Sack, 1 point. Interception, 2 points. Fumble recovery, 2 points. Touchdown, 6 points. Safety, 2 points. Blocked kick, 2 points. Kick or punt return touchdowns, 6 points. 0 points allowed, 10 points. 1 and 6 points allowed, 7 points. 7 and 13 points allowed, 4 points. 14 and 20 points allowed, 1 point. 21 and 27 points allowed, 0 points. 28 and 34 points allowed, -1 point. 35+ points allowed, -4 points. Defensive touchdowns aren't common, but they have a huge fantasy impact when they occur. For example, if a linebacker makes an interception, it's worth 2 points. But if he runs it back for a touchdown, he gets another 6 points. Anytime you can score 8 fantasy points on one NFL play, that is a sweet play. Remember, on average, a team defense should score around 5 to 10 points in a good week. But a great week, 15 to 30 fantasy points, or a terrible week, 0 to -5 fantasy points, can decide a game. Every season, coaches will draft the projected top 3 defenses early, from rounds 8 to 12. The problem is that team defenses rely on so many variables, making their performances hard to predict and their value rarely worth such early round selections. You have 32 team defenses to choose from, and less than half will be drafted. Thus, you'll have a chance to stream a productive unit with a good weekly matchup during the season, even if you wait until a later round and miss out on a highly ranked defense in your draft. Getting advanced with IDP scoring. More advanced leagues with intense commissioners and coaches who want a bigger scouting challenge offer individual defensive player IDP scoring options. In an IDP league, each fantasy coach drafts individual defensive players and uses individual scoring, much like individual offensive scoring. Because you're probably a beginning fantasy player, I suggest you first focus on team defense leagues. That's why most of this book focuses on team defense. However, if you do want a little bit on IDP leagues, this section gives a quick overview on scoring. IDP leagues break down the defensive players by three.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.